Dr. Vicki Peterson here. This is part two of a video that we did a few days ago on inflammation. So I started that video talking to you about what inflammation is, and basically it's a good thing when it's out of control. And so it's good when it's not out of control. Obviously when it's out of control it's bad. And in control, inflammation is the type of thing you experience when you have a sprained ankle and it's sore for a while, or you have a sore throat until it heals, it's sore, or you cut yourself and it gets red and inflamed. That's where that word comes from. And that's normal and natural, and it means your immune system is healthy and your immune system is attacking a bad guy, and you want that to happen. What you don't want is that inflammation to keep going and just get out of control. So we kind of aligned it to a forest fire, you know, that a little fire to cook your dinner and keep you warm around the campfire is great, but if you forget to put that campfire out and it turns into a forest fire, then obviously you have a big problem. Same thing in the human body. So it's that chronic inflammation that's doing a lot of damage. And what kind of damage is it doing? It's causing heart disease and cancer and diabetes and dementia and depression and autism and obesity. So most of the things we want to avoid, the big killers in this country, and certainly obesity is a killer ultimately because it leads towards so many other diseases. These are the things that inflammation causes. The good news is you can get a handle on that. You can actually do things in your life and in your diet to make that so much better. So last time we talked about the things you shouldn't do, and today I want to talk about the things you should do. So try to see that video first, and the idea was to kind of isolate what things you're doing that aren't good and start eliminating them, and then we're going to go through a list now of the things you should do, and we'll pick maybe the top three for you and start doing them, and we can really then reverse your health status in a beautiful way. It's not hard. That's the really exciting news, is this is not difficult, but it's very, very powerful, okay? So the first thing you want to do is eat a natural plant-based diet predominantly, because plants like fruits and vegetables are very high in what's called phytonutrients. Phyto is P-H-Y-T-O, but phyto just means plant, and nutrient, you know what that means. So it's the nutrients coming from plants. So that's a big word, not very complicated. But these phytonutrients, these nutrients that come from plants, are naturally anti-inflammatory. So any inflammation you do get from your diet because you ate that cookie at lunch or whatever else you did, you had some milk in your coffee, the things that are inflammatory, if you have enough anti-inflammatories countering them, that's a really key way to start, okay? Now, obviously some people are in worse health than others. I'm just going to kind of give you a blanket basic, and you know what kind of shape you're in, you know how much you need to do this. So some people have a little wiggle room, some people have absolutely none. You kind of know who you are, right, based on how you feel. So plant-based diet, we like 7 to 9 servings of fruits and vegetables every day. Needless to say, if you don't start that at breakfast, you are not going to make it. It's going to be a very large salad for lunch and dinner otherwise. So and we want variety. We don't want just iceberg lettuce for, you know, lunch and dinner, and you say, wow, it was huge, so that was 7 to 9 servings. No. We want fruits and vegetables that, and predominantly vegetables of those 7 to 9, that are very rich in nutrients. So they're richer, the darker they are, the darker green they are, that leaves out iceberg lettuce, and also the brighter in color. So, you know, red peppers and raspberries and things that are very rich in color tend to be rich in these phytonutrients. So we want 7 to 9 servings of them. And basically, in addition to plant-based, you want real food. So it grew and you ate it like that. You know, it's the difference between eating a nice little new red potato or eating potato chips. One is, you know, pretty natural, and the other one absolutely is not. There's been a lot done to it. So that's the other thing you want to think about with your food is how close is it to how it grew in nature. You know, a Twinkie? Nowhere close, right? Okay. We want to get an oil change. I think that's a cute expression, but what it looks at is the fact that oils and fats are very, very important, and good oils are very anti-inflammatory. You probably heard about the omega-3 fatty acids. Those are the good oils found in fish. They're also found in flaxseed. You can take an omega-3 supplement. These are very, very anti-inflammatory, very good for you. And so are good oils like olive oil and almond oil and hazelnut oil and macadamia nut oil and coconut oil. And coconut oil is a saturated fat, which sort of puts it in the bad category, but far from it. It happens to be a saturated fat that's very good for you. So coconut oil is good. Now, there is a blood test that we can do on patients to see what sort of shape their fatty acids are in, because there's omega-3s and omega-6s and omega-9s. And this is a blood test will sort of tell us what needs to be worked on and what needs to be decreased in the diet. So you need more of this, you need less of that. But testing aside, you can do a lot with just what you're choosing to put in your mouth. So those are the good oils. And you're eating small fish like sardines and herring and some wild salmon. Not the salmon is a small fish, but the herring and sardines are. And they tend to be low in the heavy metals and high in the omega-3 fatty acids. Wild salmon, you definitely have to know what the salmon was fed and where it came from and how large a fish it is to make sure you're not also getting mercury toxicity along with your fish. Exercise is so important. So what's the best exercise? I'm always asked, what's the best exercise I should do? And guess what it is? The one you'll do. So find something you will do that's exercise and do that. Then we can refine it as far as, oh, this is better than that, you know? As an example, swimming is not that great for losing fat because the buoyancy in the water you want actually needs some fat. So it's not like the best fat burner. If that's the thing you love to do, is that better than sitting on the couch and doing nothing? Absolutely, okay, because exercise is anti-inflammatory. You do need to learn to do something relaxation-oriented. I love that one thing that's recommended, which is a hot bath, which is my favorite thing, and I literally do it every night. And that doesn't have to take a long time. It doesn't really cost you anything, unless you want some bubbles. But it's very relaxing, and it's something that actually has a therapeutic effect. Deep breathing exercises, yoga, things you can do on your own. Doesn't have to take a long time, but every day put something into your daily regime that's relaxing, okay? And it's very, very important that relaxation comes in there because it takes down your stress hormones and it's anti-inflammatory. What else do we have for you? Finding out if you have any food allergies or food sensitivities, that's a little bit harder. I wanted to mostly focus on things that you could control yourself without needing a test. I can tell you that the most common food sensitivities we run into are gluten and dairy. So a lot of people remove those from their diet for a good 4 to 6 weeks and see how they feel. And you can definitely do that. It's free. It doesn't require a test to do so. And not a bad idea. Food allergies are different. Those are foods that you tend to react to within an hour or so after eating. So you usually can figure out if you have a food allergy based on a quicker reaction. Food sensitivities have a much more of a delayed response, actually up to 8 days after eating a food. So they're a little harder to identify, but certainly gluten and dairy is a good start. Taking a good probiotic is important. So you probably heard of those good bacteria. And eating some yogurt is not enough, plus it's a dairy product. So you want to actually go to a reputable health food store and get a probiotic that has, it's called, 20 billion CFU, which means colony-forming unit. So it means that these bacteria, these good organisms, actually form colonies and they make more good guys in your gut. So 20 billion sounds like a lot, but that's a good level to start with. You also want, it's good to have a combination of sort of like bifidus and lactobacillus, also that it's of the human strain because it'll colonize better in your gut because it's of the same strain that we are. And then last but not least, finding a really strong multiple vitamin mineral, vitamin D if you need it. A lot of people are deficient in vitamin D, and vitamin D is very anti-inflammatory. So this is getting into purchasing things, I know, and I didn't want to get into that, but I just wanted to mention that as hard as we strive to eat well, we often do need a little assist, a little extra help, and a good vitamin and mineral supplementation can help. Sometimes people who don't eat fish, like myself, will take a fish oil supplement, and once again, the vitamin D is important. So I know that was a fairly long list, but look back at it, listen to this again, write some things down, and see maybe the top three that you want to start with to make changes, okay? Start making those changes. Let me know how you're doing, and I'll help you from there. But this is a very key step you can make to really reverse some of the negative effects that you've been creating on your health, maybe unwittingly, by just eating the standard American diet. So I hope you found this helpful, and until next time, I wish you very good health.